Hello, welcome to the introduction to reality modeling. My name is Mark Rietman, I'm a consultant in the reality modeling and mapping team from Bentley Systems, and I'm based in Brisbane, Australia. What we're going to do in this session is we discuss about what is reality modeling, some real world examples. So I'm going to show some examples from different users, use cases, and some how we use the model, some examples from external software, how we can use this model for, let's say, road design of virtual inspections. Before I start with the software, I will talk a little bit about Bentley Systems. So this is what we call our dashboard for different type of applications we have for different type of subjects. So what's interesting in this one is that you can see that context capture, that's Bentley reality modeling software where we create 3D models from photos, comes back in different type of playbooks. So for example, if you do campuses, you can use applications as Open City Map, maybe Open Building Designer, but also context capture. For road design, Open Roads Designer, again, we can use context capture reality modeling in there. So you see in most of the industries where we are serving infrastructure objects, utility network is context capture, for example, coming back. Even process plants, bridges, nuclear plants. And we see more and more in that users are coming up with new ideas how to use this type of software. So that's quite an interesting market at this moment, I think. So what is reality modeling? It's a technology where we can really make quickly 3D models from photos, so basically a digital twin, and it can be a capture from, for example, from a fixed wing drone, normal drones, but not only photogrammetry, but also point cloud and mobile point cloud scanners, and from a plane to handheld scanners. So it's a whole range of type of input what we can have, different type of photos. So how it's gonna look like? We have here the photos, we put it in the software, we get a mesh model out, and then you can use it in different workflows. So for example, in mapping, asset inspections, construction monitoring, digital twins, and many more. So for example, we have users like the police, removal from rail objects, or all kind of objects where you can see this software really from use. So the overview is where we're going to use it in a design. So let's say you want to do a road design on this area, you have to capture the existing condition. Traditional, we went in with a surveyor, with a total station, capture the data. Lately, users are using point cloud, but we still can do, of course. But point cloud is really relatively expensive compared to a drone. You can do large areas really quickly. So we use it to understand the existing conditions. We do risk management, and we do use it for design. Later, I'm going to show you an example where we have a mesh model and we do a road design on top of it. Also, during the construction phase, we check changes. So we have users who are creating models like once a week or once a month, and then compare it to the design, so you can see if there are any changes. We document the constructions, but also like for payment to contractors, so you can see certain stages, so you know if a contractor did his work and you have to pay him. And then in the operation phase of a project, we do asset management. So we can linking attributes to it. We can do virtual inspections. So what I said before, we can do with things, for example, cell towers or bridge inspections. And we can use it for training and simulation. So for example, we can put it in HoloLens, or we can another VR application where you can walk to your, let's say, your plant site. So the technique, it's what it is we capture photos with a certain amount of overlap, but we need a high-end overlap. So one photo is not enough to make a 3D model. We need to have at least every point what you want to model need to be in three images, and we need a lot of overlap in different angles. And we can do something like this, like a statue or small objects, till flying with a drone, and we can use different type of techniques. And about the capture technique is we're gonna do discuss that in another session, because that's probably the most important of the whole reality modeling, understanding what output you want to have and how to capture the data. So every quality output you want has a different capture technique, come closer, different angles. So it's quite important to define the output first. So we see an example with a drone just flying around, shooting certain angle objects. And then we have users who are more survey, bigger survey companies who create 3D models from cameras under a fixed-wing drone or under a plane, like high-end cameras with different angles at one time that is shooting in a 80 images in a left, right, forward, backwards, creating city models or whole countries. So again, a little bit the setup. So we can use phone models. You can capture data with a phone, and it's important to understand that you can really get good models from the phone because you can come closer to the object, but you need more photos than, for example, if you have a high-end camera, more megapixel. Yeah, you have to shoot less photos to get the same quality. So digital cameras where we can do certain objects, drone, different type of drone, and also that cameras under the plates. And we can have a combination of data. So I will go later. I'm gonna show you an example where the user fly with a drone. Certain objects they want to have more detail. Take the digital camera, go closer, shooting objects, shooting more images closer, combine the data, and then you get what we call a multi-resolution model. So you get an example, you have something like this. You can capture it with different devices or a combination of devices and get an output. I have some examples collected, so I'm going to show that in a context capture viewer, but first I want to show one of our users. Aerometrics is a company in Adelaide, Australia, and they have offices in the United States also. They did a city in Bendigo in Victoria. This is a video. So it started playing. And they capture this with a combination of devices. So probably they use a helicopter. So they sit in a helicopter shooting images. And they can also shooting images with a handheld camera and then combine it. So they can also do plane or and even point cloud scanners. I'm not sure what devices they are using for this project, but you can see they did handheld camera because you can see under objects. This is something you cannot see from the drone or from the helicopter. So this is really one of our, I think the best user we have for this, for doing this type of projects. But you also notice that there are no cars, no people. They clean up, so they do a lot of retouching and cleaning up the model. So this is, I think, a really high-end quality model. So if you want to see more models from them, just Google Aerometrics. And they have different type of models online and also a lot of videos. So this is a model from a video. Now I want to show you some live models. So let me go out of the PowerPoint presentation. I've got here an external drive with a lot of models on it, and I will start with a bridge. So what you see, the format is in 3MX. This is a Bentley format. We have different type of formats. We can export a lot of output, different type of outputs from context capture. If I double click, it opens the context capture viewer. A context capture viewer is also available as a free viewer, so you can go to our website, download the viewer, and you can use it for free. And a little bit about the viewer itself, what you see, we have some tools here, some display tools. You can do wireframe and texture mode, but you can also do that from a shortcut. So W is wireframe, T is texture. We have measurements tools in here, so we can measure coordinates. Depends on the coordinate system you select here, MJ55. We can do distances, so we can do between objects, we can do surfaces, and we can do volumes. And that, yeah, I don't really have an object to show volumes. Maybe we can show it later in another model. So this bridge is captured with an Mavic Pro 2 and 20 megapixel camera, really small drone. But if you check the quality for inspections, so I think it's really good quality. I can change the texture and the wireframe, so you see something like this. Yeah, it all depends on what type of quality you have. I mean, this model doesn't really have objects underneath, but you can also capture that on the side of the bridge if you want. Depends on what capture technique you are using. So we can also in this viewer record videos. So for example, if I click something, I can click on an object and press a key point, another key point, another key point. Every time you want to go somewhere, you press a key point, and then if you play it, you have an animation. I already had this one in this project, so you can really quickly, you can go to full screen mode with F11, and then you can record your screen and you have a video of your model. Of course, we can do that also with other applications where we can do more animations, but the viewer is really powerful. So that was a bridge, and let's see if, something else. So let's go to buildings. This is a really simple building. This is an capture with a Phantom 4, and we just fly twice around the building and then capture something. The reason that as a good example is simple flying, nothing special. I think everybody can do that. But you can also see in this model that we can only capture what we can model what we can see. So you see some issues over here. But for the rest, it looks really easy, good quality model. And then, yeah, you see something like this. So this is a good example to show that volumetric option. So we can do simple something like this. And we see the volumes based on the plane what I just draw. But you can also, if you want, you can set your own custom plane. So simple building. So if you want to have a little bit more advanced, yeah, better building. So for example, I can show an object here that's Fort Denison in the Sydney Harbour. So it's a really huge model, and was a work in progress from our government user. This is a government user in New South Wales. Takes a little bit long to roll, but it's a really nice model to show. And this is a combination of a 42 megapixel camera where they go with a boat around the object, fly drones, and I think also some parts with handheld camera. And if you see the quality, this is really, yeah, good quality. They use it for brick replacement, so they can measure in here. We see in a lot of ground control points what they use for measuring and scaling. Yeah, if you ever go from the ocean to the harbor bridge, you're gonna pass this island, so it's quite an impressive model. But there's a 42 megapixel camera, and we can also doing with a handheld camera. So this is a model that's only done with a handheld camera, not with a drone. So we had two cameras, we walked around, and this is a training tower, so you see, because it's only handheld, there's no roof, and you see some issues over here, for example. Yeah, so there's a hole in it because you can only model what you can see. So what you can see is also, a little bit of shading, but for the rest it's a really good model what we can do just with a handheld camera. And later I'm going to show you some of the objects on where we merge drone and the handheld data set. So this is in the building space. We have users doing inspections on, for example, cell towers. Yeah, cell towers is a little bit more complex to capture. So let me open a tower model. Phantom 4 Pro, couple hundred, I think it's a little bit more than 1,000 images. And you can see something like this. So I've seen higher resolution models from our users, and we have a user in the United States where we work with. They have two 61 megapixel cameras, so that's the model is better than this, but it's also, of course, on price. This is a $2,500 drone, while the other one is a $60,000 drone. But that depends on where you want to use the model for. So we can do something like this. This is a little bit more complex capture technique than if you do, for example, just a building. If you go more in the city modeling, so we already showed an aerometrics model. Another user from us is Nearmap, and I'm gonna show the New York model. So this is an Australian-based company. They make 3D models and 2D auto photos from I think whole Australia and big parts in the United States. So this is New York, and to give you an idea, this is 400 gigabyte data on an external drive. So if you view the data, and I want to show you that I'm really in New York, so you get a model like this. But what you also see, and let me capture something here, this is captured from quite high. They're flying high, they capture a lot of data and process it really quickly. So this is a completely different quality than a high-end drone model, but that's also where do you want to use it for? So I think it's quite impressive. Their models, I mean, I see models from planes that are better than this, but they're flying lower and they capture way more data, more processing time. Something like this. So if I go in the same type of data, we can have also users flying with drones, doing city modeling from drones. So this is a partner from us in China. So they work with a camera rig. So there's a five drones on a five cameras on a drone, and you can see they have a 542 megapixel camera. The Sony A, I think the Sony A7s. And they're flying 170 meter high. If you then see the quality, you can't really compare it with that model from New York, but you can see something like this. And also, if you see, the buildings, the quality, what you can see here, it's really impressive, I think. And this is just adding the photos in the software and start processing. So there's nothing, there's no cleanup, nothing. It's just like it is. Yeah. So we see users doing something like this. I got more examples, but this is more a little bit from the same. If you talk about fixed-wing drones, so that was captured from a fixed-wing drone, we have also models from the Wingtra. Wingtra is a vertical takeoff and landing drone. And let me go to, I can go to this one. But this is a single camera. I think this is a 20 megapixel camera, but only a single one. So if you shoot looks okay from this. So if you see this building, and this is 135 meters high, but if you see the side of the building, yeah, it's not really nice. Depends on where you want to use the data for. So this fixed wing Wingtra drone, we see that often users are using that in mine sites. If I go, for example, to an something like this, where they, yeah, capture something like this, where the 3D model is, the 3D quality is not that important. Other type of models, we see a lot of interest for things like the iPhone. So let's capture a data set that I did with my iPhone 8. Couple hundred images shooting around. I scaled it based on points that I measure in the model, and then you get something like this. Yeah, I think a good quality just from things like an iPhone, you see here. And the advantage of if you walk around with an iPhone, you can come really close to the object. So yeah, you can really create something like this. Heritage sites, we have users doing heritage objects. So let's go. So we've got an object here in Vietnam, where I downloaded a data set from a free website, and what we just this is a combination of drone and handheld. So this is probably the drone quality at the top, and then the handheld quality is what you see on the walls and here, for example. It's a little bit hard to zoom in, but something like this. There are some use cases. We have a lot of government users doing this type of stuff. Let me see what I show now. Yeah, users are doing something like this. A person. This is captured with a certain type of camera rig system where we shooting a lot of images at the same time. So you can see he needs to shave, but his ear is quite clean. See a little bit on the rail side. So we have users capturing a rail is quite dangerous to get in that a red zone, what they call. They have to stop the train from coming, so they prefer to do. Oh, sorry, I want the model and not the video. And this was quite challenging because we were not allowed to fly on top of the drone with this over top of the rail, so we have to do it from the side. But then, in general, I think we get a really good model out, considering that we couldn't fly on top of it. If you fly on top of it, you can get a better quality model. We can do things like this. So this is also a handheld camera doing a pit. So when it's open, users want to capture the utilities, the location. So instead of measuring it, we can go in and doing something like this. And you see QR codes are used for scaling and geo-referencing. Think about the time. Yeah, so that was all photo input. We can also do video as an input. So for example, I got an did a project in Cambodia, and we found this object Angkor Wat on YouTube. I downloaded a YouTube video, and there is a music on. Let me toggle the music off. So this is just a YouTube video what I just downloaded, and then I put it in context capture, and then this is the output of the model. You can also, of course, capture. We have users who capture. We will capture with video, because it's sometimes easier to do than photos, but yeah, it's not really It's a good model if you consider it comes from YouTube. Plant models, we see a lot of interest nowadays from users who are want to do digital twins. So got a plant site here, and what we did is we capture with a drone, and then we went in with the handheld camera and merged images together. So this is drone quality. But then the user want to have certain objects more detailed than this, so we went here with the handheld camera and we capture data and then merge the data sets together while we can, so we can read objects like, yeah, this, for example. So this is a drone and handheld. Yeah, I think this is a little bit the models that I wanted to show, considering the time that I have. Let's go back to the PowerPoint. Some examples how we can use it in different type of software. So this is Bentley software. This is Brisbane. So this is a Nearmap mesh model. So Nearmap provided this model to us, and what we did, we loaded it in an application we call Open City Panel. It's a cloud-based application, and when we can load different type of data set, doesn't really matter what type it is, we can load most of them. This is, I think, just a Collada file. Design, we can flatten down a mesh, so you have the mesh model, the design model, we put it on top of the mesh, and yeah, if you want to do a reconstruction or so, you really want to flatten it. We can do things like point locations, different zoom points, we can do shadow analyze it, so we do something like this. We also have, and we didn't show that in here, but a way to communicate with end users, user engagement forms. We can set up forms where user can have comment or click something or rate it if they like it or not like it, so something like that. Yeah, some measurements tools, of course. So let's continue with the next one. So this is an application, this is Open Roads Concept Station, where we can do conceptual road design. And I skip a little bit because it takes a little bit long. So this is a golf course, and we have here a mesh from this area, and we want to design new road on top of here. Let me skip this bit. So what we do, we loaded the data, the 3D data, so that this is loaded, the 3D mesh, and then we can design a road on it. So this software is has its own standard, so I think from every country or area where we're working in, we have all the standards. So over here we select what type of roads, is it less than two lanes with a certain type of profile, and this is 3D. So our mesh model is in 3D, so that's different than if you do it from an orthophoto. So object is designed, and then you can also create one with a lower speed over here. So he snapped to it and it's automatically connected. And then what he now can do is design for example, a roundabout on it. So you see over here, roundabout is created. So this conceptual road design, you can export it to other type of applications. And there's also a price behind it. If you, we don't show it in here, but you can have a price behind it. So a roughly estimate of the price. This is not a Bentley application, but it's a Siemens application where they do VR. So they have We have a reality mesh created with context capture. You place your object and you can walk to your model and see. So a little bit more on training part. There are more applications who can do that, and we can load most of the realty meshes in these applications. So click on an object, see line of view and attributes. The next one is the HoloLens. So this is an Bentley application where we can load the mesh model and in any other model in a HoloLens and can do a virtual inspection. So there is, I think last week, Microsoft was showing bridge inspections with our little bit same bit and a bridge inspection with our software. This is probably really interesting to experiment with. This was my session about introduction in reality modeling. If there are any questions, this is my email address. Otherwise, go to our website. We have a lot of information about our software and also about reality modeling software. Thank you.
If you found this video helpful, please give it a like. If you want to see more such series, consider subscribing to our channel. Thank you, and see you next time.